Welcome to Amphetu. Today we are discussing on oxygen generation. Yes, the whole country is debating, worried about the oxygen availability, the scarcity of oxygen. So why can't we use the atmospheric oxygen directly for the patients? What is the limiting factor? And what is that all complexity in generating and storing and transporting the oxygen? What is the liquid oxygen? What is medical oxygen? Many, many questions are flying to our mind when we see the news regarding the oxygen scarcity. Today, we are going to discuss very briefly about the subject for you to get a fundamental understanding, so that you can further read through and understand and grasp better on the subject. Let's go to the presentation.
We do have oxygen in our atmosphere. Then what is the need of oxygen cylinders? The answer is very simple. We have 20.8% oxygen in atmosphere, but that is okay for a normal person to breathe. But when it comes to a COVID patient who is suffering from a pneumonia or who is suffering from a breathing disability, we need to supply him pure oxygen so that the lungs will be able to extract and utilize that oxygen for his keeping his breath. So how can we generate oxygen, and what is the general process of oxygen generation, oxygen plant? Let's go through quickly on the technology part of it. So the oxygen plant very primarily works from the atmospheric air, which is utilizing the atmospheric air. The air is compressed to 94 pressure per square inches, PSI, or which is an equivalent of 650 kilopascal or 6.5 atmosphere. That compressed air is cooled using a water cooler. After cooler, we call normally as. Then a certain water vapor in the air will be condensed, and that condensed water vapor can be separated by using a water separator. Then the air, after removing the water vapor, the more pre-treated air can be passed through the molecular sieve, which has agents like adsorbents like zeolite and silica gel. Very normally we can see those adsorbents in many of the packings to reduce the moisture content inside the package. And one thing, very important thing to note down, is we normally keep two parallel sieves, so that these sieves has to be flushed, cleaned up very periodically. So when one sleeve is a sieve is flushed, taken for cleaning up, the air can be passed through the second sieve. Similar way, when the second sieve is being flushed, the air will be passed through the first sieve. That is the importance of keeping two parallel sieves. And after this adsorption, it can be again compressed, and that compressed air can be cooled for improving the density. A high pressure compressor is used over here, and compressed and cooling will improve further the density, and then it is allowed to expand to an atmospheric level. So this expansion process will bring down the temperature. Sudden cooling will bring down the temperature. It is technically called an adiabatic expansion, which brings down the temperature and this temperature reduction will cause the oxygen, because the purified air, the filtered air, has major components like oxygen, nitrogen and argon, out of which oxygen has relatively the highest boiling point, which is equal to minus 183 degrees Celsius, equivalent to minus 297.4 degree Fahrenheit. So the oxygen gets liquefied and it can be fed to a low pressure fractionating column. So again, here you can see one portion of the airstream was fed through the compressor, then it was expanded, and then it was fed to the low pressure fractionating column. And a major second split of the airstream will be passed through an exchanger and is fed to a high pressure fractionating column. And in that fractionating column, the air, when it goes to the higher, which is when it is flowing high to the top, we can see further heat is taken away from the air and the oxygen gets condensed at the bottom. So that oxygen can be taken to a subcooler and fed to the low pressure fractionating column. So in the fractionating column, so the pure oxygen, which is 99.5% pure oxygen, get condensed, liquefied and settled at the bottom of the fractionating column. The nitrogen compound, which is having a lower boiling point of minus 195.8 degrees Celsius, which is equal to minus 320.4 degrees Fahrenheit, remains at the vapor stage and goes higher in the fractionating column. The argon gas, which is in midway between the oxygen and nitrogen, remains in the vapor and can be extracted to a crude argon chamber. Then, very important thing is, normally the liquid oxygen, we can transport a maximum of 500 miles or 800 kilometers, because the more it transfer, the longer it transfer, the heat exchange happens and it gets converted to a vapor stage, a gaseous stage. To avoid that, a distance of travel is limited, and if at all we have to transport a farther distance, like we have seen the tankers which are coming from Saudi Arabia or many other countries, and the industries which are producing the liquid oxygen, which is transferred to the different hospitals across the country, are stored in the cryogenic shells of bigger tankers with this, you know, double walled and insulated without by shielding a heat exchange. So that's a way of transferring the liquid oxygen. And here we can transfer through the pipeline to a farther distance as much possible, like an 800 kilometer. So this is a way the liquid oxygen, 99.5% pure oxygen, being produced. In another episode, we'll explain how these oxygen cylinders are fabricated, the materials, the fabrication properties maintained in the cylinders. All those we'll try to understand in a different episode.
Today's session was having a few technical jargons, scientific terms. Doesn't matter. I hope you all could get a fair understanding about the topic so that you can read through further. And we'll meet again in another knowledgeable session in AmphiTube. Thanks once again.